Hello, dear student. Welcome to Scores of Linguistics lessons. Today, we will be talking about structuralism. Structuralism is a school of thought which was developed first in Europe by Ferdinand de Saussure in his book Course in General Linguistics in 1916. According to structuralism, language is a system of interconnected units. Basically, structuralism views language as interconnected units. Units of language, they are interconnected. They are connected with each other. We're talking here about sounds, vocabulary, or any linguistic elements. The structuralist principle states that language is a self-contained relational structure, the elements of which derive their existence and their value from their distribution and opposition in text or discourse. So basically, the structuralist principle is that language is self-contained relational structure. Self-contained means that language, so the structures of language are self-contained, they are independent. Okay, if we talk about, for example, phonology, so we're talking about structure of language, we're talking about phonology, morphology, syntax, semantics, etc. So these structures, or these levels, the structures of language are independent of each other. Okay. However, they are relational. So there is also, they are related in the sense that they operate systematically at the same time. Okay. And the element of which derive their existence, so the elements of language derive their meaning, their value from the existence and from the distribution of their opposites. Okay, each element derives its meaning from the distribution and oppositions in text or discourse, their existence, the existence of other elements that are the elements that are surround, so the elements that precedes, for example, an element, or the elements that can be replaced by other elements. So we have opposition, so that is the elements derives its meaning from its opposition. In the structuralism, we have de Saussure as the father of linguistics. So he is the one who very famous, well-known linguist in this school of thought. He came up with some dichotomies. So he contributed to the field of structuralism by coming up with four dichotomies. The first dichotomy is signifier and signified. This means that language is a system of signs. A sign has two components. Signified is an idea or concept, while the signifier is a means of expressing the signified. For example, the sign, like a word, is thus the combined association of a signifier and signified. So basically, this is what he means by signifier and signify is that any word, a word, for example, if we take any word, okay, that word is the signifier. And its meaning that we have in our, that is internalized in our mind, that's the meaning or the concept, okay, is the signified. Okay, so the word is, or the symbol, okay, is the signifier, and its meaning is signified. This is still also distinguished between two inseparable compounds. Okay, so we're talking here about the same components, just another explanation between two inseparable components of a sign. So this signifier and signifier, they form a sign. So when you're talking about language as a system of signs, means that language is a system of a word and its meaning. So in language, we have words and we have their meanings. That is the signifier and the signified. Both of these components form what is what de Saussure names sign. Okay, so distinguish between two inseparable components of a sign, the signifier, which in language is a set of speech sounds or marks on a page. So it's a set of speech sounds, words that we pronounce. Okay, and then we can write, for example, so we're talking about the talking about the signifier, that is the word. It could be, for example, a word that we say, or you can write a word, okay, in a piece of paper, for example. And the signified is the concept or idea behind the sign, behind the signifier. This is an example. So we have a signifier, for example, the word peer. So we have P, D, and E, and A, and R. So these are simple. This is the word. This is the signifier. What this word means in our minds, this is the concept, what it really means, is the signifier. The meaning of, so when you think of a peer, it comes to your mind, the pears, the fruit. So that's the concept. Okay, another dichotomy that this is came up with is parole and long. So long and parole. Okay, Swiss. This is here. He's Swiss, of course. This is also distinguished parole or actual individual utterances from long, the underlying system of conventions that make such utterances understandable. In other words, long is the language system shared by a community of speakers. Parole is the concrete act of speaking in actual situations by an individual speaker. So long is the language system shared by community. So the language that we have in our minds. And once we produce language, we produce it, that's parole. So it is the concrete act of speaking. Once we speak, when we speak, that's parole. Okay, and that parole comes from the language that we have acquired, and that's long. Okay, this is an example. So we have parole, it's the individual, when an individual speaks, so parole is individual. However, language that we have in mind is shared by the community. Okay, another dichotomy is called synchronic and dichronic. Okay, synchronic and dichronic. Synchronic is the study of a language at a given point in time. The time studied may be either the present or particular point in the past. That is, one describes a state of language disregarding whatever changes might be taking place. So another dichotomy here, we're talking about synchronic, means the study of a language at a particular time. So we don't study it from its historical point of view, but you want to study language, study it now. So we want to study language, for example, 200 years ago, you go to that very particular point in time and then you study it. Okay, so we study language at a given point in time. That is what we mean, or what this is here means by synchronic and his followers, of course. Diachronic, on the other hand, is the study of language over a period of time. That is, language is studied from point of view of its historical development. Okay, so diachronic studies language through historical development. It studies, for example, language at each period, okay, any time, okay, at each period in time in the past, for example, you go to, so we studied like 200 years ago, when you study it 300 years ago, when you study it 400 years ago, and then you come again, each period of time you study language to see how it develops, okay. So this is what we mean by diachronic study. In the 20th century, synchronic description has come to be regarded as prior to diachronic description. So the linguistics, they take this approach of synchronism, which is better, okay, than diachronic approach. Okay, for them, for linguistics now, the synchronic adaptation of, or the synchronic study, is adopted in studying languages. They study language at a given time, or in a given at a given point in time. Okay, this image shows. So we have, if you look, we have diachronic historical point of view. There is one line in diachronic. There's one line. Okay, that's timeline. Okay, so they study it every time. And if you look to synchronic, so we have slices. So you take one of these slices in time and then you study language, okay? Only one, not like over and over and over again. You take one of the slices, one point in time, and then you study language. Another dichotomy is called syntagmatic and paradigmatic relations. So this is your distinguishes between the syntagmatic relations a linguistic element has with the element preceding and following it, and following it in an utterance or a sentence, and paradigmatic relation it has to do it has to other elements with which it shares identity. So syntagmatic relation means that elements have, when we talk about that, the fact that elements have syntagmatic relation, we means that each word has a relation with the word that comes before it, precedes, and the one that follows it in a sentence, for example. And when we talk about paradigmatic relation, we talk about here about the replacement. So an item can be replaced by another item. It could be a synonym or an opposition. Okay, let's take this example. We have an example: the cat sat on the mat. This is a sentence. So the cat precedes mat in a linear order. Of course, we cannot say the mat sat on the cat. So it's, the sentence is meaningless. It's not logical. So if we look at the sentence, so the cat comes before sat. Sat comes before on the mat. Okay, corresponding to plural structure in speech. We would say cat before. We cannot say, for example, we would not say cat before mat. Okay, so we cannot say, for example, mat before cat, but we would say a cat before mat. This relation is syntagmatic. And then we have a paradigmatic relationship. For example, each of the words in one could have been replaced by a number of other possible words. We can replace the cat, for example, by the boy, okay, my birds. We can replace sat by another verbs. Okay, so as if you look at the first definition, we have that paradigmatic relations. We have elements with which they share identity. So we have the cat, which is a noun phrase, can be replaced by other noun phrases. Verbs can be replaced by verbs. A preposition replaced by position. So the elements are replaced by other elements with which they share the same identity, same grammatical class. And in the mat, which is, for example, the NP is also noun phrase, is also replaced by other noun phrases. Okay, so the cat sat on the mat. The relationship of each word with the one that precedes it is syntagmatic, and the cat sat on the mat can be replaced by the boy jumped over the rock, can also be replaced by birds escaped from their cage. These relations now are paradigmatic. The words in each of the element into are related to each other paradigmatically. They are related by being alternative possible choices. Each word there has its possible alternation or alternative element. While elements with or which are related syntagmatically are all present, so if we look at the sentence, the cat sat on the mat, all elements are present in the sentence. Okay, the elements which are related paradigmatically are mostly absent. Okay, so the paradigmatic elements are absent. Okay, we can only look for them when we want to replace them, when we want to replace a certain sentence, for example. This is an example. So we have the syntagmatic relation, and we have which is horizontal, and we have the paradigmatic relation, which is vertical. Okay, you can take a look at this page and analyze it so that the image becomes clear to you. In the United States, so now we talked about structuralism in Europe. Now let's move on to talk about structuralism in the United States, in America. So the term structuralism or structural linguistics, okay, my used, so these two terms refer to the same thing, has had much the same sense as it had in Europe in relation to the work of Franz Boas and Edward Sapir. So mostly structuralism developed in the United States by Franz Boas and Edward Sapir. Sapir was interested in the relationship between language and thought, but it was left to one of Sapir's students, Benjamin Leworth, to present his work sufficiently. So, of course, Seppe did not write his work on his own. He was a lecturer, so he taught at the university. And then one of his students, Worf, took his notes and then added some notes to them. Okay, and then he published Sapir's work. Okay, since the publication of Worf's work, more important papers in the 1956. Okay, the thesis that language determines perception and thought has come to be known as the Sapir-Whorf hypothesis. So Worf published his work, okay, and called it the Sapir-Whorf hypothesis because Sapir and his student share the principle of this hypothesis. Under the influence of Sapir, Worf developed the concept of the equation of culture and language. So this hypothesis basically became known as the Sapir-Whorf hypothesis, which states that the structure of language tends to condition the way in which a speaker of their language thinks. Hence, the structure of different languages led to the speakers of those languages to view the world in different ways. This means that our language determines the way we think. Okay, language determines thought, shapes thought. The way we think is determined by language. If you take the Arabic, English, French, each of these languages shapes their speakers, okay, in different way. Okay, so the way, for example, an Arab person views the world is different from English person, different from a French person, and so on, so forth for all other languages. This hypothesis was originally put forward in the 18th century by German scholars John Gottfried von Hader and Wilhelm von Humboldt. Okay, these names, they are scholars are German. So it was exposed in the United States in the period preceding World War II by Sapir, and then in the 1940 by Worf. On the basis of his research and field work on American Indian languages, Worf concluded that the formulation of ideas is part of a particular grammar and differs as grammars differ. Okay, so the structure of grammar, okay, determines the way we think. Okay, so this is basically what Worf concluded in his work, in his research on American Indian languages. Another linguist in America, which is also a structuralist, is Leonard Bloomfield, 1933, published his work entitled Language, in which he attempted to lay down rigorous procedures for the description of any language. So we came up with some procedures, and that anyone who wants to describe language, that is the linguistics, should adopt these rigorous procedures to describe language. Bloomfield's prominent concern was to establish linguistics truly as a science of language. So he wanted to establish linguistics as, you know, truly as a science. Okay. His main concern was to delimit the role of linguistics in relation to other sciences, that is to make linguistics a science on its own, and which it doesn't share any other it doesn't have any other relation with other sciences. So to be linguistics to be a science on its own, to be independent of other sciences. To develop the principles and concepts of linguistics into a well-balanced and unified structure. So they wanted to develop the principles and concepts of linguistics to be balanced and unified structure. He restricted the job of linguistic inquiry to the formal characteristics of linguistic utterances. So the task of of linguists, according to Bloomfield, is to study the corpus of utterances. So we study the utterances as they are produced by native speakers. And then you discover, so discover regularities and structures. So when you study the corpus, you try to find, okay, what are the regularities and the structure of the utterances you're studying. That's the job of linguists. Bloomfield wanted linguistics to be empirical, descriptive science. So he wanted, this is what is meant by, wanted linguistics to be truly as a science, that is, to be empirical, descriptive science. Thank you very much for your attention. I hope you enjoyed and learned from this video, and see you in the next video.